this afternoon on Article 25 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and Basic Income. It's very uplifting being here, being amongst such dedicated people who care. I'm Victoria and I'm here with my colleague Sonia, and we're from an organisation called Share the World's Resources. I know we've met some of you already on our stand outside. Share the World's Resources is a campaigning group that's based in London. It was set up by Mohamed Mesbahi about 15 years ago and has consultative status at the Environmental and Social Council at the United Nations. We make a case for integrating the principle of sharing into world affairs as a pragmatic solution to many of the global crises we're facing, such as hunger, poverty, climate change, environmental degradation, and conflict over the world's natural resources. We also advocate for an emergency program of relief in order to bring an end to poverty-related deaths as a top global priority. This session this afternoon is specifically on using Article 25 in order to pave the way for a universal basic income, which we see as something that should be a fundamental right for all people in all nations. The way it's going to work is I'm going to speak for about 30 minutes or so, present our ideas and our thoughts to you, and then afterwards we will open it up to any questions you may have and to a discussion. So basic income, as you know, is being discussed by many groups. Sonia and I actually went to the Basic Income World Congress a few months ago in Portugal, and there were 33 different countries represented there. So it's being discussed all over the world in different ways. There are trials going on all over the world. And what we are offering specifically is a strategy to strengthen the case for a full, genuine global basic income to be implemented globally all around the world by utilising Article 25 as the key to global cooperation. It's an approach you might not have heard before, and we are offering it for your consideration. So our approach is a global one. We're looking at the world as a whole, about how we can address all our interlocking crises, which are all fundamentally caused by the injustices built into our economic systems. We're going to talk about how we need to change the way we look at the world, about how we're going to need massive civic engagement and participation in order to bring about the necessary changes. Our governments have failed us again and again. All the problems are worsening. So any lasting solution is going to have to come from all of us, the people of goodwill. We don't see any alternative. So the perspective we're coming from is a holistic one. We're looking at the world as a whole. We're looking at humanity in all its diversity as one united, indivisible whole. This concept of oneness isn't just some hopeful philosophy we have. It's actually backed up by many fields of scientific investigation, from really fascinating biological research through to quantum physics. So the Universal Declaration of Human Rights has 30 articles. It was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in 1948 and was signed up to by all countries at the time, although it's never been fully guaranteed for the majority of citizens around the world. This is Article 25. Everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself and of his family, including food, clothing, housing and medical care, and necessary social services, and the right to security in the event of unemployment, sickness, disability, widowhood, old age, or other lack of livelihood in circumstances beyond his control. Motherhood and childhood are entitled to special care and assistance. All children, whether born in or out of wedlock, shall enjoy the same social protection. Before going any further, I would like to invite you just to take a few moments to imagine a world in which Article 25 has been fully implemented and we're living with sharing and cooperation at the heart of how we relate as a humanity. Imagine that the basic needs of everybody are met. Everyone has enough to eat, somewhere to live, free healthcare, freedom from worrying about money. How might we be spending our time differently? How might we be relating to one another differently, knowing that everybody has their needs met, knowing that those who are currently, those millions who live currently in dire poverty are having their needs met for the first time? Well, unfortunately, the current reality in the world is very different from this at the moment. So how did we get here? How have we come to allow so much suffering? Because instead of recognizing our oneness, we've actually been living with a sense of separation from one another for countless generations. And that has led to greed, selfishness, competition, nationalism. And we can see these themes running through all the structures we've created, for example, in politics, in economics, in education. And we also have rampant commercialization that is dividing us even further still and is deepening the very stark wealth inequalities both within and between nations. Our mainstream education systems seem to churn out an assembly line of good consumers, and so much of life is about profit making now. This really deeply ingrained process of commercialization is leading to an ever worsening overuse of the world's resources, as we know, leading to environmental degradation, climate change, natural disasters, droughts, floods, and so on, as well as heartbreaking poverty and destitution, which sees an estimated 805 million people suffering from chronic hunger at the moment, and 40,000 people a day dying from poverty-related causes as we speak. In fact, we are living through the biggest food security crisis the world has ever known, with the threat of famine in Yemen, Nigeria, and Somalia, whilst at the same time we have food rotting away in storehouses in other parts of the world. We also have the largest refugee crisis since the Second World War, with more than 65 million people displaced due to climate change and conflicts and so on. I find it really hard to get my head around the level of suffering in the world. At least 70% of the global population don't have access to any kind of social welfare or protection. It's hard to imagine what it must be like watching your children suffering from malnutrition or even starving to death. A friend of mine came back from Mexico with stories of poor mothers who would boil stones in a pan of water to calm down their hungry children, who thought this must mean food is coming. And of course, as we know, suffering in the West is also increasing as well. There's a huge rise in homelessness, which we see around us. Food bank use has gone up. Over 1 million people used food banks in the UK last year. Welfare systems are becoming more stringent and cruel, and in many countries are being handed over to private companies. Now, successive governments the world over have not only failed to resolve all of these problems, they are increasingly allowing market forces to influence world affairs. And it seems we are at a crossroads, and we are faced with a very stark decision. Either the governments of the world need to cooperate and work together to share the world's resources, of which there are actually enough for all of us, despite our current level of population. Or we just continue along the same path of greed and destruction to the point of no return, which, if our climate scientists are right, will be within a very short timescale indeed. So how can we get from where we are now to a truly just and sustainable world? Well, this is where Universal Basic Income, or UBI, comes in. It's one of the most important social movements of our time, and we at Share the World's Resources think it should be something that's available to everybody the world over, so that nobody has to live in poverty. And what we are arguing is that before full and genuine UBI schemes can be implemented around the world, there would first need to be a massive redistribution of world's resources something along the lines of the vision of the 1980 Branch Report, this book here, which some of you may remember. The economics are obviously very out of date, but the central principles and ideas still stand good today. What this group advocated for was a massive redistribution of the world's resources and also a complete restructuring of the global economic systems in order for our world to survive. Unfortunately, world leaders today are beholden to powerful corporate and financial interests, particularly the arms industry, and they're not even serving all the needs of their own people, let alone cooperating and sharing on an international level. It seems as if the prevailing ethos is more one of the right to kill than the right to live. But it would be a very different situation indeed if Article 25 was made fundamental law around the whole world, because governments would be obliged to meet the needs of their people before the profit interests of corporations. They would have to come together to cooperate in order to share the world's resources, and they would have to be thinking of the common good of the world as a whole rather than just their own national interests. We're not suggesting that a global call for Article 25 is a substitute for UBI. They are both equally important. But what we are saying is that a partial basic income on its own, just implemented in the richer countries that could afford to, is unlikely to last in the long term. If we think, for example, Switzerland, which is a country that's got as far as putting it to a referendum to their people as to whether to have a citizen's income or a basic income there, if they were to go ahead with that, it may well last for some time if they could maintain control of their borders, but say after a length of time with outside pressure from corporate globalization and commercialization, it would be very hard to maintain. Likewise, there are many smaller schemes going on around the world. There are pilot projects which are having generally very good results. We would suggest that perhaps also they would corrupt within the current paradigm of commercialization in much the same way that our social welfare systems corrupt in the political and economic climate that we have at the moment. The current state of the world is very volatile, and the financial sector is particularly unstable. Many top economists are predicting another financial crash, and if they are right, it's going to be far worse than the last one and will cripple many countries. If that were to happen, do we really think that basic income would stay on the agenda in those circumstances? However, if Article 25 was to be successfully implemented, the implications would be enormous. There would be tremendous knock-on effects, very far-reaching. We have this book that Mohamed Mesbahi has written on heralding Article 25, People's Strategy for World Transformation. And in it, there are many examples of the kind of implications we would see if Article 25 was truly implemented. And we've chosen a few from the book for you to look at. There would be an end to life-threatening poverty and hunger if our first priority is to redistribute food and essential resources to the most impoverished world regions. There would be an end to land grabs. There would be an end to food speculation and the hoarding and destroying of food to affect market prices. Debt would be cancelled. There would be de-escalation of military activity alongside steep cuts in armaments budgets as resources are redirected to the people. Tax havens would be ended. Population levels may eventually decrease and stabilise, as it's well known that poverty is an underlying factor in the rapid population growth for the past 60 or 70 years. Trade rules would become fairer, and there would be increased North-South cooperation through an emergency programme, with further manifold implications such as a binding UN climate treaty and drastic action to save our environment. There is, in fact, a whole section on the environment in the book, because by using Article 25 to address the problems of poverty, we are actually also addressing the environmental crisis simultaneously. Poverty and climate change are inextricably linked, and they are both driven by the same process of commercialization. So in a lot of these examples here, we can see how there would be an impact on the environment as well as on poverty. Once we realize the interconnection between these three things, between commercialization, poverty creation, and climate change, then we can understand how it's only through sharing the world's resources that we will be able to address all these issues at once. So having outlined a case for implementing Article 25, the remaining question is, how are we going to persuade all the governments of the world to finally guarantee it for all of their citizens? Well, given that it doesn't look like they're about to wake up to reality, we suggest it's only going to come about through the massed goodwill of ordinary people calling for Article 25 through enormous, continuous, peaceful global protests. We really shouldn't underestimate people power. Can we imagine what an impact millions of people would have if we stood behind one single idea? Article 25 is a unifying idea. It's such a simple statement of basic needs for adequate food, housing, healthcare, social security. It's so easily understood that it could appeal to very broad swathes of the population who may not even usually consider themselves to be politically engaged. Article 25 is a unifying vision, and it could bring together rich and poor alike. Even the most wealthy person is likely to agree that we should all have the very basics in life. And it's certainly going to appeal to the poorest amongst us, those who live in neglected slums and villages. It would have a relevance and a meaning to them in a way that perhaps other global concerns or people power movements might not do, such as the Occupy movement or the Arab Spring, for example. Article 25 is the key to resolving so many of the world's problems. In fact, embedded within it are many of the demands of bygone activists down the ages up to the present day. It's an umbrella which incorporates so many of the issues and campaigns that we are all involved in. And it's the surest route we have for impelling our governments to redistribute the world's resources and restructure the global economy. But are global demonstrations possible, we might wonder? Well, we've seen recent activist movements like Occupy and Louis Debout, which spread very quickly from one country to another, although they weren't sustained for long enough to reach what they wanted. We have seen how protest can work if it's sustained for long enough to see it through, such as the suffragette movement and the civil rights movement in America. There was a film in 2014 called We Are Many, which some of you may have seen, which explored the worldwide demonstrations against the war in Iraq in 2003. And many of the commentators in that film actually talked about how those protests should have been ongoing rather than just for one day. So coming back to this book again, Heralding Article 25, Share the World's Resources book, it really compellingly explains why continuous mass demonstrations is the only way that we're going to achieve the end goal. I can highly recommend it. It's a very good read. The central argument in the book is this. Only through uniting ordinary people on a global level with an informed mind and a compassionate heart that asks, what about the others? Can we shift the priorities of our governments? Lobbying politicians on domestic issues alone will never be enough. We see such ongoing protests as being global like nothing that has gone before. We're talking about activism and movement building on an enormous scale. Our world has never been in such a critical state before. And it needs a change of consciousness and the mobilisation of millions to change it. To come back to UBI one more time, we're not suggesting that UBI campaigners do anything any differently, or in fact anyone that's involved in any campaign to change what they're doing, other than to also demand Article 25 alongside their campaigning activities. To conclude, the world is in, we know, we're facing so many enormous global challenges at the moment, and it's going to take global solutions. Just relying on our governments to do the right thing leaves us complacent to the suffering that's around us. But if we could truly understand that the suffering of others is also our own suffering, that nothing separates us from the other, then perhaps we would act differently. The world is an interconnected living being, and if part of it is sick, then that will eventually affect the rest of the world. We see this really clearly with climate change, with the mass movement of economic migrants from poor countries, with the influx of refugees into Europe. What happens to the poorest of our citizens also affects us, because we are one humanity. So let's not just fight for our rights in the West, but let's fight for all our brothers and sisters the world over, those who are dying of hunger right now, those who are living with poverty on a daily basis, and bring them hope for the first time in their lives. Questions that have come up, and then see if this can develop into